Let's talk about that a little bit. Someone shut the door, please.
Ron.
Shut the door.
Someone shut the door, please. We don't want strangers. Off the street coming in to here to our organic chemistry.
You know what? You don't want
people private session here. Okay, guys, aromaticity. Aromatics. Everybody heard dioxins? Very, very bad stuff, particularly for the environment. Okay? Vietnam, there's other places, chemical. This is a nice paper about dioxins, an overview in history. It's from the journal Environmental Science and Technology. Down here somewhere, it talks about how dioxin is known as the most toxic man-made substance.
Now, I don't know that it is, but...
So, what type of structures do we have here? Largely aromatic. We've got these two benzene rings. The center ring is not aromatic, although you can maybe make an argument about it. You've got these chlorines. But it is an aromatic compound. It's particularly stable. That's why it persists in the environment a long time. It doesn't degrade into less toxic things. That's just an example of something. Okay. Molecular orbital theory. First off, any questions from our intro to benzene? Questions from our intro last time? Okay, well, I'm thinking about it. The test on Monday, right? We'll have nomenclature. We'll have, for those that have before getting one, it's very similar style to that. Because it did not typically begin with nomenclature, and we did do some nomenclature right. There'll be a few multiple choice questions. Okay, the final exam in this course will be 70 multiple choice questions, so I like to get you a little used to multiple choice. You see plenty of those in the workbook. Then there'll be like predict the product, synthesis, you know, this reaction gives this, a lot like the quizzes, yeah. With the synthesis or the predicted products, it could give you maybe starting material and product and say what is the reagent. Or it could give you reagent product, what would be the starting material to give this. Okay. Mechanisms, okay, using correct arrows appropriately to show all electron movement. Okay. Just like an organic one. All right, we learn how to do mechanisms there. The general format of mechanisms. We also looked at multi-step synthesis. Okay. There'll be maybe some short answer questions, you know. And then there will be a comprehensive spec problem, like in the workbook. Everything we've covered. Any questions about the test on Monday? No? Okay. Let's get started with molecular orbital diagrams. The yellow sheet, we can maybe start there. Golden sheet. Basically, the outline. Up top, structure of benzene. Well, we covered all that last time. We looked at those topics. Now we're ready to move down to three. What was two? Oh, experimental evidence. We looked at experimental evidence, right? Okay. Okay, comparison of benzene, a very stable molecule, to cyclobutadiene, which is these two molecules here. Okay, we talked about that. It's aromatic, very stable, etc. What about this guy?
Unstable.
Is that aromatic?
No.
Well, why not? Well, why is that aromatic?
How close are
we? We said this was aromatic when it's a cyclic conjugated system. Well, isn't that also a cyclic conjugated system?
It is.
So why is one aromatic and one not?
You need to have
the number of pi bonds.
Yeah.
Number of pi bonds?
Yeah.
So why does that matter?
It's in
It has to do with the...
We need to answer that question.
Yeah.
We need to make sure we're okay. These are both psychic conjugated systems. So you can't say that any psychic conjugated system is aromatic, because that one is, but this one's not. This one is actually highly unstable. This is actually known as anti-aromatic. Okay? Define here. We'll modify these or clarify these as we go along. But both are fully psychic conjugated systems. So what's going on here? The only way to really see it is to get into the molecular orbital theory. Okay? And that's where we will get into. Now, in Organic One, I don't know how much other people cover, but I don't cover hardly anything for MO. Did y'all do anything in other class for MO?
No?
Okay, MO. One thing I told you about in Organic One is I usually tell you, like, oxygen. Okay? If you draw oxygen like this, that looks like a pretty nice structure. Yeah? Lone pairs, okay. Standard bonding for oxygen. The problem with this is oxygen is paramagnetic. We know that from the lab. The only way to be paramagnetic is to have unpaired electrons. So where are the unpaired electrons? This valence structure doesn't show that. It's a failure of valence bonding theory. If we look at molecular orbital theory, though, we'll see unpaired electrons. Okay? Two different theories. Valence theory is taught predominantly at the introductory level. Because if all we did was MO theory, you guys would really not like it. Okay. All right? Because that's a little bit higher up. But some people only do MO theory. So that's it. But let's look at it more. We do need to do MO here. Okay, we can start with a non-aromatic. How about an MO of butadiene, which is a conjugated diene we saw in Organic One? How can we draw an MO diagram? The MO diagram is always going to be of the P orbitals. We're only doing MO of the pi system. How many P orbitals does this compound have? Okay. Four P orbitals. That should be very easy. How many pi electrons? How many?
Four.
Four. Four P orbitals, four pi electrons. Okay. That's taught the first and second week of Organic One. Alright, so there's nothing new there. Now, of course, if you want to draw the orbitals in, you've got P orbital, P orbital, P orbital, P orbital. One electron, one electron. There's your four. These are bonding. These are bonding. There's your two pi bonds. Is there any bonding between these two?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, you've got to know that's there. That's resonance. That's conjugation. But this is where we start with. You always want to start with, what are we dealing with here? Okay. Molecular orbitals. I'm just going to do it and explain as we go, because I can't explain everything up front. This is important. Thus, for MOs, four P orbitals don't get four molecular orbitals. These are atomic orbitals. That is, right? That atom has a P orbital. It's an atomic orbital. It's hybridized, or actually that's not hybridized. Some of them can be. A molecular orbital is an orbital that's spread out over the entire molecule. One orbital over the entire molecule. Wow. But that one orbital will hold only two electrons. What does it look like to be spread out over the entire molecule? How do you spread it out over here? Well, first off, ultimately, a lot of this is largely based on math. Okay? But let's do it as we can. Four P orbitals get four MOs. What are they going to look like? Maybe we'll draw them. But what we mainly, first off, we want to be able to do is to do a MO diagram, energy level diagram. And the energy level diagram of our four MOs, which we know. Well, for this guy, we're going to have one, two, three, four. These are the four MOs, okay? Energy level of them, this is energy. Just like if you did a, in Gen Chem, you did the orbitals, start with 1s, Then what's above 1S?
2S.
2S? Then 2P. Okay, it's the same thing. These don't have quite as clear names. Which is the lowest energy MO? Well, it's going to be this one. What does it look like? We haven't showed it yet. Now, there's always going to be a midline. The midline is going to run symmetrically through your MOs. So here the midline will come through here. It's actually symmetrical through the energy, not through its 2 and 2. We'll see more examples. Here it is, 2 and 2. 2 below, 2 above. We'll better define the midline maybe at some point. How do you get those? How did you get those? Basically, these p orbitals can combine in different ways. It's actually even simpler if we just start with one double bond. But hopefully in your reading, in your textbook, you'll see just one. I'm doing two double bonds. Let's go back up here. Boom, boom, boom. These are the p orbitals. I'll draw them back in. As we go forward, I won't actually draw the orbitals in. You'll see that. These four are all going to combine to make one orbital, called a molecular orbital. What are different ways they can combine? One way is for them to all combine in phase. All four combine in phase, that's one way that they could combine. Okay, now we look at this by saying that this is a bonding interaction, this is a bonding interaction, and this is a bonding interaction. So it's all bonding interactions. And the electrons are spread out all through here. Okay, you can do something like this if you want. Okay? But this is the best way it can combine, and this is this one down here, the lowest energy MO. Okay? Maybe we want to call that A. This is A. What's another way they can combine? Pretend the orbitals are there. I don't want to use up all my ink. Well, this could be plus, this could be plus, but that could be minus and that could be minus. That is, the phases are different for those two compared to these two. But since these are in the same phase, these are overlapping, we're going to call this a bonding interaction. These are in the same phase, so they're overlapping constructively, we call that bonding. But look at here. Are these interacting to make a bond? Constructive overlap is what a bond is of the orbitals. No. What is the interaction between these two orbitals? P orbitals, right? I just didn't draw them. That's an anti-bonding interaction. The phases are, they're not in phase. And this is largely, again, based on math. You also see this in physics. Think about in a lake or the ocean or somewhere. Two waves can come together and make a bigger wave, but that's only going to happen if they come together in phase. What if they come together out of phase? They can actually cancel each other out and it'll go, that's the same thing with sound waves. That's why you can somehow have dead space where the sound waves cancel each other out. Okay? Same thing going on here, and you can take it back to math. But that cancels, there's no bonding there. So we have sort of like, if we draw in the bonding, we have electron density here and electron density here, but there's no electron density between those two. And actually, when you have a plane of no electron density, what's that called? I reckon I don't expect you to have heard this. I wish you had heard this sometime. That's called a node. Okay? A node is a plane where there's no electron density. There's that one. Now, is that one as good as this one? It's not because you have less bonding. For example, you can sort of check the bonding. For example, how many bonding interactions here? Three. What's the net here? That's going to cancel that. What are you left with? One bonding net. One bonding net is not as good as three bonding net. Not as good means it's higher in energy. This is B. That's A. Circle that. Keep it from separate from the B of bonding. A little bit higher in energy. But importantly, both of these are bonding MOs. How do we know that? What's the net here? Bonding. What's the net here? You see? Just this one is better. That's still bonding net. Okay. What's another way to combine?
Boom, boom, boom.
First off, importantly, how many nodes did this one hit?
One.
One node. How many nodes did this one hit?
Zero.
Is there a plane anywhere through here where there's no electron density? Correct, there's none. Okay, here's some free information. Don't tell anybody I told you this. As you go up, you're going to get one more node. This one's just going to have how many?
Two
nodes. How many is this one going to have?
Three.
Okay, that can help you draw them. That can help you draw them. Now the nodes come symmetrical. Now if this was straight, it'd come right through the middle. If you're going to have two, where would you put two? You're not going to put one here and one there because it won't be symmetrical. You actually, if you're going to have two, one goes there, and the other one goes where? Over here. So if this is plus, what do you want this to be?
Minus.
How do you know it's minus?
Because there's a node.
Because the node indicates that there's no overlap. So that's got to be minus. Now what do you want this one to be?
Minus.
Also minus, because we do have overlap here. Minus just means same phase. Not charge or anything. What do you want this one to be?
Plus.
Okay, there you go. The nodes help us draw it. Now again, I'm not drawing in the orbitals. But we're saying that if they overlap like this, it will give a certain molecular orbital. We'll have this energy. We'll have two nodes, check. What's the net bonding? Well, what is this? Anti-bonding. What is this?
Anti-bonding.
And what is this here?
Bonding.
What is the net?
One anti-bonding.
One anti-bonding net. So what type of orbital is it? It's an anti-bonding molecular orbital. And guess where that goes? Not below the midline, but
above
the midline. These are going to be anti-bonding MOs. And C, this is C. That is, if you could take a picture of it, you would see there'd be no electron density between here and here, but there would be some here. Okay? What's the last one? Well, go back to this. 4p orbitals can combine four different ways. Trust me. Here are three ways. What's the last way they can combine? I should have drawn this lower. Let's go down here. This is actually going to be D down here. How many nodes?
Three.
One. It doesn't matter how you do it. It's between here and here. It's three nodes. If that's plus, what is this?
Minus.
If that's minus?
Plus.
And?
Minus.
Okay. What's the net?
Three
anti-bonding net. Okay, anti-bonding. You don't have any bonding between your atoms in here. It's pretty bad. Pretty bad. That's why it's the highest in energy. Okay, but it is an MO. That is, the p orbitals could be sitting there with that type of combining. Actually, ain't much combining there. That's one situation. That is an MO. The electrons would have to just sit on each atom There'll be no electron between sharing between the atoms. Three antibonding net, that's the one up top, that's D.
What's to stop the molecule from just rearranging its electron density?
It's a good question. We may answer that in a little bit.
Well, first off, maybe there's no electrons in that envelope. How many electrons do we have?
Four.
You put them in just like you did in Gen Chem, using what? Off-Pol principle, Pauli exclusion principle, Hund's rule. Okay, same way. Where do you want to put the first one? Right here. Where do you want to put the next one?
Still in A.
Right here, because you feel degenerate. Well, there is no degenerate, but here. Where's the next one?
There.
Where's the next one?
There.
There you go. There's your MO diagram for butadiene. All electrons are in what type of MOs?
Bonding.
The electrons are in bonding MOs. Okay? There's actually no electrons in there, so it's almost irrelevant. You can actually argue if there's no electrons, does it actually exist? Well, I don't have an answer to that. But this is what this setup then allows us. Like when we do UV vis, we say we excite an electron. Well, excite an electron to where? Now we hopefully see it. We can excite an electron to a higher energy molecular orbital. Okay?
That
falls
down spontaneously.
Yeah, you can do lots of good stuff like that. Yeah. Yeah, you can excite it with some energy, but it can fall back down. When it falls back down, it may give off heat or it may give off light. There's a variety of mechanisms for that. Yeah. What do you want to call this MO? This is called the HOMO. What does that stand for?
Highest occupied.
What do you want to call this one?
Lowest
unoccupied molecular orbital. So in UV vis, you often see the term, we're going to excite an electron from the HOMO to the LUMO. Okay, let's turn to the next one. Now let's do benzene. Alright. Benzene, how many p orbitals are we dealing with?
Six.
How many pi electrons?
12, 6, I'm stupid.
How many MOs are we going to make?
42.
Six. Six P orbitals give six MOs, okay? We can go ahead and set up the diagram. Okay, here we go. We're going to have one. There's always only going to be one at the low, because there's only one way that it can combine perfectly. Then, here we go, a little bit different. We're going to have two degenerate. And we're going to have two more. Then we're going to have one at the top. And we're going to have a midline come through here like this. Okay? This is energy. I'm not going to do that. Every time we do this, this is energy. If you were doing it for a report, you'd want to draw your line. Okay? There are your six. What's going on here? Why do I have two degenerate molecular orbitals? What does degenerate mean? They're at the same energy level? Okay? What can we say about these before we go on? These are what type of MOs?
Bonding
MOs. What type are these? Antibonding MOs. Okay? Because a lot of this setup is going to fit any MO. How many nodes will this guy have? There's actually two of them. How many nodes? One, because your lowest has perfect overlap, no node. As you go up one, okay? All right, I'm going to maybe do these here. Boom, boom, boom. See if we can get them in. Okay, pretend there's six P orbitals there again. Okay, I'm going to show the dumbbell P orbital. What's the best way for these six to overlap?
All.
All in the same phase, all the way around. What's the bonding net here?
Six.
Six bonding net, right? Bonding, 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 all the way around. That's the best. That's this one down here. Okay? What's another way for these two combining? Well, first off, I think it's useful to say, how many nodes is this one going to have?
One.
Okay? And we can put a node right here. Now, if this is plus, what is this?
Also
or go this way if you want. If that's plus, what is this?
Minus.
What is this?
Minus.
And what is this?
Minus.
What is this?
Plus.
And what is this?
Plus.
Okay, there you go. You got electron overlap up here, down here, but there's none here. And thus, if you saw this, here's my overlap. There's nothing through this plane here. It's a node. What's the net bonding? Bonding, 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 bonding.
No, but
it's two. Let's do this here, okay? What's that? Bonding, bonding. What is this? What is this? What is this? What's the net here? Yeah. Two bonding net. There's going to be another one. They will both have two bonding net. Still bonding, but it's not as good as this one. What's another way? Now, here it is. Because it's cyclic, you can get degenerate. That is, you can get another one that only has one node. All right? What if we drew it right through here? This is actually through atoms. If this is plus, what is this?
Plus.
And what is this? Okay, that's actually good. And this is what? There you go. Because in this case, we're saying that there's no electron density on the carbon. The node comes right through two carbons. What's the net here? Bonding, bonding, what's the net? Two bonding net, like we said. There's two ways to get two bonding net. That's why there's two at this level. Those are degenerate. They have the same energy. This is a result of it being cyclic. Okay? What's another way that they could combine? How many nodes would the next level have?
Two.
Two nodes. We can have one right through here and one right through here.
Wait.
If this is plus, what would this be?
Minus.
Why didn't anybody ask about this being antibonding?
Because
these are not next to each other. Okay. But everybody saw that? Okay. That's plus. What is this? And what is this?
Minus. Plus. Minus. Minus.
What's the net here? Can you add it up?
Yeah, it's still two.
Two antibonding.
Wait.
It's still two.
No.
Two antibonding.
Oh, negative two.
Two negative two.
Yeah, that should be
positive. Okay, that's not a negative. That's equal. Equals.
Two antibonding.
Two
AB. Antibonding bind cancels.
Anti-bonding.
Yeah, I have to write a note. Anybody write a note? I think it's two anti-bonding net. Anti-bonding. We expect it to be anti-bonding. We put them above the midline. Two nodes. There's another way to get two nodes. I think we can come right through and like that. If that's minus, this is plus. That, if that's minus, that's plus. And that's also two antibonding net, because all you have is just two antibonding. There's nothing canceling. Two antibonding net.
Those are those two.
What's the worst way?
Well, the worst is you don't even hardly need to use nodes to get it, because it's actually all the way around. But it's three nodes. It's going to be boop, boop, and I reckon like this. Let's see if that gets it. Plus, minus, plus, minus, plus. Does that work all the way around?
Yeah.
Does that work out? Should be six antibonding net. That's the worst one. That's the one sitting up top. If we can look at the electrons here, they're spread all the way around. Continuous overlap. If you can look at the electrons here, you have electrons here and here. There's your electron density. If you can look at electrons here, where are they at?
Here. They're all isolated. There's no overlap, okay? It's like that.
So, is it possible for like the node lines to go through the carbons, or is that?
That's what we did here.
Okay, but for the last one.
Yeah, I think we could do it another way, and you could get three nodes. As long as you have three nodes and six antibody net,
but if we
did, there may
be
another way.
There'd be no electrons.
Yeah.
There'd be no place for electrons to be if it went through all the carbons. The top.
Yeah, if it went through the carbons, you wouldn't have six.
Are you talking about all of them going through the carbon? No, I don't think you don't want them all going through. But you may could do it with one. I'm not sure it doesn't really matter. But here we had it going through two. If you could take a snapshot of this, you'd see electrons here, and there'd actually be no electron density on those atoms. Okay, let's keep plowing ahead. We could sit here and talk for three or four lectures, but we don't have that long. Write your questions down. Make sure you try to get them answered through either your textbook or me or whatnot. How many electrons do we have? Six. Put them in. One, two. Where next? After this, where do we go? If you have degenerate, you fill all them first with one. What rule is that?
Hund's
rule. Four. Now we start pairing up. Five, six. What do we see?
All bond.
All your electrons are in bonding MOs. Just like over here. By the way, we did point something out over here. What else do we see here? All electrons are paired. Pair electrons, pair electrons, pair, pair, pair. All electrons are paired in both of these. That's another very important thing. All electrons paired. Okay. Now let's do one of cyclobutadiene. Alright? How many pi orbitals with that guy?
Four.
How many pi electrons?
Four.
First off, is it a conjugated system?
Yes.
Well, we'll say yes to begin with, but that's actually, this only works if it's a conjugated system. Because if it ain't conjugated, they ain't going to be overlapping. Okay. All right. Cyclobutadiene. We have four p orbitals. How many MOs are we going to make? Four MOs. Okay. It's going to be one. Then we're going to have two, and then the fourth one will be here. There are your four. Where's the midline going to be in this case? The midline through here is actually right through here. So these two fall on the midline. Okay. I don't know why I like to draw north turn. I think maybe if you draw the p orbitals, it's easier. But okay. What's the best way? All the way around. What's the bonding net?
Four bonding
net. Electron all the way around.
Okay.
It's this one down here.
What's the next one going to look like? How many nodes?
One.
Let's draw one node like this. If that's plus, what is this?
Plus.
Plus, what is this?
Minus.
Minus and minus. What's the net here?
Zero.
What is this? Antibonding? Bonding? Antibonding, and what is this? What's the net?
Zero.
It's neither. It's zero. And that's why it falls on the midline, because it's neither. We can get another one like this by putting the, I think if you go right through here, we call that plus, what do you want to call this?
Minus.
What's the net here?
Zero.
Nothing. Okay? Zero bonding or zero antibonding. It's okay? There's no net of either one. That's why it's called. Actually, we do call this something. This is called a bonding molecular orbital. This is called an antibonding molecular orbital. What do you want to call this one?
Non-bonding.
It's actually called non-bonding MO. Two non-bonding MOs where there's no net of anything. All right, what's the worst it could be? Two nodes, plus, minus, plus, minus. What's the net? If you add it up, I think it's four antibonding. It's four antibonding if you add those up. That's the highest one. Okay? Any questions about that? Again, You can go to math and you can look at the what's called mathematical combination of atomic orbitals, and you can get a lot of high advanced math about all that. All right, but let's fill it in. How many electrons we have? Four. One, two, three. Where's the next one? Unroll. There you go. Four. Do you see any difference from benzene? Tell me differences. You have electrons in what type of MOs?
Non-bonding.
Does that sound good?
No.
It ain't good. It ain't as good as having them in bonding MOs. What else do you see? Are all electrons paired? No. All electrons are not paired. You have two unpaired electrons. What do you want to call that? If you had one unpaired electron, it would be called a what? A radical. What do you want to call this?
Diradical.
That's a diradical. Does that sound happy and stable?
Yeah.
No, it does not. Okay. And you have electrons in non-bonding. That's not as bad. We'll actually seem to see some that are reasonable to have that. The main thing here is the diradical nature. That's why that guy is so unstable. It's actually a diradical, and we see that if we understand some basic molecular orbital theory. Basic. Okay. Questions? Can you explain why cyclobutadiene is so unstable where benzene is? Can't just say they're both cyclic conjugated. Okay. First off, a few things that I could have said. When we drew the MOs of benzene, they're actually, must be the white. Probably white. Where is the white? Here it is. There are your six MOs of benzene. That's from a top view. Right here. Electron overlap all the way around. It's like a donut at the bottom. Okay. This one, what I said here, that's the one up there on the left. Do you see the nodes? You see I have a node through here? Node? Is there a node here? No. How many nodes there? Okay, the nodes are there. That's a depiction of the actual MO. All right. What else can we look at? Oh yeah, keys to drawing MO diagrams. What we just did is summarize right there. Okay. Like I told you, that's free information. No charge for that.
Are we paying for this class though?
There's also a mnemonic down below. Okay, some books put that in. Let's skip down on here to, how about this guy? Don't read, please don't read, never read.
It's a diorama.
Chuck, is that aromatic or anti-aromatic? Aromatic or anti? This is an eight-membered ring. What's the answer?
Anti.
How do you know it's anti?
Because it has a high electron.
How do you know it's going to split in the middle?
Because that's a pattern.
You recognize a pattern?
Yeah.
Well, so did someone long ago named Hoko. Okay? Hoko recognized a pattern and he called it a rule. He's like, my pattern's going to be called a rule. Okay? Here we go. Now, we could go through all this and see it. Okay? See, Hoko also knew that students wanted more of a, quicker answer. Maybe we should do it real quick. I think we should. Let's do it as if we weren't using Hoko's rule. How many pi orbitals?
Eight.
Eight. How many pi electrons?
Eight.
By the way, this number may vary at some point. Okay, let's see what we can do. And what I would expect you to do, because draw an MO energy diagram. I'm not asking you to draw what the orbitals look like. The energy diagram, that's that thing. Well, how many MOs are we going to put on the board? I mean, MO levels. Eight? Okay. Eight P orbitals are going to give eight MOs.
Four levels, all right.
I'm not sure because this is how I would do it. There's always going to be one at the bottom because there's only one way to overlap good. There's no comparison. Okay? Then we're going to go two. You're going to go two, two, two until you run out. Now at the very top, depending on the number, you may end up with two at the top or just one. That's three, that's five, that's seven, so we need one more. So we will have a single one at the top. There's your eight. Guess where you can find that information? On the page that's called Keys to Drawing. Okay? All right, where's the midline? We may have to evaluate this. Where do you want to move the midline through?
Middle.
Actually, right through here. So these three are what type of MOs? Those three are, and what are these two? There you go. Okay, eight electrons. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. What do we end up with? Diradical. So is this aromatic or anti-aromatic? Yes, it's anti-aromatic according to the MO diagram. One thing at a time. First, how do we know it was going to be anti-aromatic? Look what we've done. The two was anti. The six was aromatic. Then the eight
I'm sorry, not two. The four. So I can do a di was anti. Four was anti. Six was aromatic. Eight anti. What about 10? It actually will be. You can do it. Okay? And there's a trend here. Huckel recognized this. Huckel's rule said that if you have a compound with 4n plus 2 pi electrons equals aromatic. Well, any compound? No. A cyclic conjugated compound. Okay? It's got to be cyclic conjugated. But if it has 4n plus 2 pi electrons, it's going to be aromatic, with n being nothing more than just a number, an integer. Tell me a number.
A little number.
Five. It could be five. And if it was five, what would this equal?
22.
22 would be aromatic. And it could also be zero.
That's an integer.
If n is zero, what are we looking at? Two. Okay. Let's get benzene, which is six, right? Six pi electrons. Benzene would be where n is what?
One.
Okay. Now, if you think about it, what answers fall under this? Well, if n is zero, the answer is what?
Two.
If n is 1, the answer is 6. If n is 2, the answer is 10. If n is 3, the answer is 14. Right? Huckel's rule says that these are all going to be aromatic. You can keep going.
4, 5, 6, 7.
All going to be. Why will they be aromatic? Because any of these, when you set up the MO diagram, they will all fall like benzene. Everything will be paired. Because it just sort of repeats and repeats those numbers. If you don't believe me, then do one for 14. You'll see that they're all going to be paired. Okay? Or,
so does that mean like the things we were assuming were would have been resonance stabilized, but they were actually, some of them would have been anti-aromatic, so we didn't have that definition, would have actually been diradical destabilized?
When did we see resonance?
I don't know, any time last semester.
No, because most of those have not been cyclic, fully cyclic conjugated. Very important, got to be fully cyclic conjugated. Maybe there was one or two along the way that we could have argued, but yeah. Okay. Now, on the other hand, what's the anti-aromatic? It's just 4N. 4N equals anti-aromatic. Now, if n is zero, you ain't got no electrons. So I probably wouldn't do that. But if n is one, the answer is what? Four. If n is two, eight. If n is three, 12. Eight pi electrons, which is what we have here. So what does Huckel's rule predict? Anti-aromatic. Here's the kicker. It's got to be cyclic conjugated compound.
Is that being considered aromatic?
But when you said for the 4N plus 2, you said if n is 0, then 2.
Well,
that
looks like. We probably will see.
Good question. Okay, here's the problem. This guy is not. Huckel's rule is just a predictor. It doesn't know real life. Okay, it doesn't know circumstances. It's not. It's actually non-aromatic. Non-aromatic. That's no more aromatic than hexane, cyclohexane, ethanol, acetone. Non-aromatic. Why? The reason is, it's not a cyclic conjugated compound. Why not? It looks like it on the board.
Oh.
Okay. Let me know people are watching this video.
It looks like it on the board.
But does it look like it in... Have you ever met this compound?
To be cyclic conjugated, it has to be planar. For these p orbitals to line up, it has to be a planar system. We haven't said that. Okay? Benzene. We'll look at model. We're about out of time. Very planar. They only line up if it's planar. Benzene. We'll say more. We'll even say more about cyclobutadiene. This guy's not planar. Look, planar would be boom. Okay? Like a stop sign. Now all the orbitals could line up, okay? First off, does it want to be anti-aromatic?
No.
No. Why would the system want to be? This compound adopts a tub shape. And once it adopts a tub shape, game over, it's nothing. It's non-aromatic. This is just four alkenes in one compound. They're not conjugated. Also, look, it's actually hard to make it planar. That's because the bonds have to stretch out beyond 120. So that's look at that bond. You see how it's no. Watch when I go tub shape.
Which one will go tub shape? See, it won't even bend right because it's been bent out of shape. Okay, we're out of time. We'll look at this next time.
It's got to be planar. It's like the time you get it has to be planar, not planar.
Really bad about responding.